All right, so in the previous video, we say that y is usually related to x being a set of the variables like x1, x2, and all the way up to like xp. And we said y could be income, or x1 could be age, years of experience, all the way up to all the factors that we think affect income, right? So in this video, we want to talk about the reasons why the reasons why we estimate f. Why do we estimate this f, the function that is going to give us an estimate of how we can connect, or the relationship between x1, x2, x3, and what? And our y. So in broadly speaking, there are two reasons why we have to estimate f. And the first reason is we estimate f for prediction purposes. So the first one is prediction purposes. Purposes. Let me write that nicely. Okay, cool. Prediction purposes. What does this mean? So sometimes we already have the inputs, but we do not have y. So in a case where we have someone who's walking into our building, we have the inputs. Let's say there's income here, right? And we have said that, yeah, we know that our income is going to be related to age, years of experience, or years of education, the school the person went to. Let's just put these three for now. The school that that person went to. Sometimes we have these inputs. We know the person's age when we see their CV and stuff like that. We know the years of experience that they have, right? And we know the school that they went to. So we have the inputs, but we do not have y. We do not have the income. So in that case, we can estimate y using our, this just means an estimate of y. We will not get the actual income the person deserves, because if you remember in our previous video, it's dependent on so many other variables that sometimes you don't even record. So here I'm just putting a hat on y to represent an estimate. So we are estimating the income using an estimate of the function. We don't have the actual function, but we can estimate the f that links our age, years. It's just an estimate, right? Our x is taking into account all these inputs, right? So we can predict y using that f that we estimate. Remember in the previous video, it was that blue curve, right? In this situation, f is treated as a black box. When we're doing prediction, estimating, when we're what do you call this? Doing this y equal to f for prediction purposes. When we're estimating f for prediction purposes, this f is treated as a black box. A black box is something that it is called a black box because you cannot see what is inside it. We do not know what is inside this black box. We cannot look inside it. So we treat f as a black box. It's something that we do not know. But if we put our inputs inside it, it will give us an estimate of y. And we do not care how it's doing that inside here, because all we care about is the prediction for y. We do not care what the processes that are going on in there, right? All we care about is it giving us whatever is going on here, the processes, are those processes giving us a good estimate of the income, right? So let's just say you have a computer program. I'm just giving an example. Computer program will ask you for the person's age, the person's years of experience, and the school they went to. And then when it takes these values, it does some calculations. You don't even know what the calculations are, what they are, and you do not care. All you care about is the prediction, the y that it's going to split out. When it gives you that y, you're going to compare, is this y accurate enough? Yes, it's accurate enough. That's all you care about. You do not care about these processes that are in the middle there, right? So when we talk about accuracy, how do you measure the accuracy? What then happens is, you remember in our previous video, we said y is equal to the actual y, f of x, the actual f, plus some error. There are some errors that are going to be there, right? So there are two types of errors that we are going to encounter. We're going to encounter errors that are called reducible errors, and the second type are irreducible errors. Irreducible errors. What is the difference between these two? Let's just give an example. So an example, let's say we record our variables or our observations. For example, we have blood samples. Let's say we have blood samples that we take from observers, from patients. We have blood samples that we take from patients, right? And in those blood samples, let's say there are some things that we look at. We look at the CD4 count in the blood samples, how many white blood cells are there, how many red blood cells and stuff like that. Those are things that we're measuring in our blood samples, right? Cool. And when we measure those things in the blood samples, our aim, we want to predict if this person will react, let's say, reaction to a drug. So we want to predict if a person wears a blood sample with, let's say, this CD4 count with these many T cells. I think these are white cells, right? This person with these red blood cells, the red blood cells, whatever it is, hemoglobin level. Let's just say maybe their iron per milliliter of blood, whatever it is, their iron level per milliliter of blood. We measure these. These are our x's. X1 is the CD4 count. X2 is the T cells, number of T cells. X3 is the red blood cells in a milliliter or whatever. X4 will be the hemoglobin level. X5, let's say, is the iron level, right? We have our X's. And now we want to predict the reaction to a drug, which is our Y. So our Y is going to take two values. Is it a yes? Is the person going to, with these measured values, is the person going to react to a drug? Yes. Or is the person not going to react to a drug? So our Y is going to take two values, right? So our Y, there is a function of CD4 when we are estimating. So we estimate our Y using our estimate of F when we put in our CD4 count. It's actually CD4, not C4D4. CD4 count, our T cells count, our red blood cells count, our hemoglobin, and then we have our iron level, right? And then we'll say, when we put this into the function, yes, the person is going to react, or no, the person is not going to react to the drug, right? So what then happens is, what will happen is, there is going to be a reducible error. Where is it coming from? It comes from us trying to estimate this F, right? It comes, this estimated function very rarely equals the actual function. Remember, there's an actual function and then there's this estimated function. If you remember from our previous video, we had those points and they had errors when we had that curve there. Those errors, this estimated function, it very rarely equals the actual function, right? This is because our statistical tools, they are trying to capture the overall pattern in the whole data, right? Errors could be introduced when we are measuring the CD4 count because of the measurement instrument that we're using. So it means our Y, our reaction to the drug, will not be 100% accurate. We want to get it as close as possible to 100. We can get 99% accuracy, perfect. But there's always going to be some level of error just because of the way we measure. Let's say maybe there are instruments that day, they don't perform well or whatever it is, but there's just going to be an error. But that error, we can always reduce it. Let's say we estimate F to be, or we will be like, Y is related to F to these X's by this way. Let's say 2 CD4 count plus 3 T cells plus 10 the count of the red cells plus 1 the hemoglobin count there. I hope I'm spelling hemoglobin right. I'm forgetting the spelling here, so I could be butchering the spelling. Then yeah, let's just say plus 50 iron level in the blood, right? So this is a linear. It's a linear function, right? It's a linear function. It's the same as y is equal to 2 2x plus 3. It's a linear function, right? So we've estimated our function f to be a linear function. But it might not be a linear function. It could be a quadratic, it could be to the power of 5 or whatever it is, right? That is a reducible error because we can always change our f to be a more accurate statistical technique. We can change it from linear. If we see that the accuracy is 60%, we'll be like, oh, okay, let's try something that is nonlinear. Let's try a quadratic. Maybe the accuracy will go to 70%, which means we have already reduced the error of prediction. The prediction was 60% accurate initially. Now it's 70%. Cool, it reduced the error, right? When we moved to quadratic. What about when we take to the power of 5, x to the power of 5? Maybe the prediction accuracy is now 90%. Oh, great, we have reduced the error. So this becomes a reducible error because we can always use better statistical techniques. When we can use better statistical techniques to improve the accuracy, we know that we are dealing with a reducible error. It's reducible, right? The second type of error, which is irreducible, this one here, that is irreducible. Let me try get an example. Okay, cool. For the irreducible error, it happens when there are things that affect reaction, like in this example, reaction to a drug that we cannot measure. Cool, maybe we've measured with 100% accuracy. All these we've measured with 100% accuracy. We are using the best statistical technique that is giving us 99% accuracy. Everything is perfect, but there will always be an error. It's never going to be 100% because of something called irreducible error that we can never get rid of. Why? It's because in this example of Y being a reaction to a drug, reaction to a drug can be due to reasons that we cannot predict, that we cannot measure. Things like the weather on that day. Weather can affect someone's reaction on that particular day, or how well the person is feeling. You know, the way your mind, when you're thinking about something, it affects how you're going to react to drugs, right? What is your well-being on that day? We cannot really measure this. Your well-being. Are you happy? Are you sad? Are you feeling a tummy? Do you have a tummy ache? What is it? So your well-being on that day also affects your reaction to the drug, and it will be very, very extremely difficult for us to include these factors into our model. So those become irreducible errors. So, right? So this is why Y will always be function of X perfect plus an error term. That error term which includes our irreducible errors, right? What then happens? If you remember well from a previous video, we said our error is equal to actual minus the predicted value or estimated value, right? So this is something that you just need to take for effect, right? Because we said, if you watch the introduction video for this course, we're not going to really get into the mathematics or statistics of machine learning or whatever it is. So take this as effect. The expected value of the squared difference, it is given by this. Imagine we are doing Y, the actual minus the estimated, and we square the two, right? So this is going to be actual minus predicted, and we squared the two. So we are just basically squaring our errors. When we square our errors, it will be the same as the expected of, what is our actual? Our actual is given by that f of x plus error. Yeah, this is our actual, right? It is the estimated plus the error terms, irreducible error terms that we cannot measure. So that is the actual. So actual f of x plus what? Plus the error terms minus our predicted is just going to be like this, because this is our estimated function, estimated f of x, right? Squared. Perfect. If we rearrange this, what we are going to see is this expected of y minus y y estimated squared is going to be given by, is going to be given by f of x, our f of x here, minus the estimated f of x squared plus. Now when you take out the error terms, it becomes something called the variance of the error terms. We're not going to discuss these. I'm just showing you some mathematics here, but we're not going to discuss that. So this EY minus Y estimated squared is the expected value of the squared difference between the predicted and the actual value of Y. Our focus in this course is how do we minimize the reducible error, the part of this E that is reducible. How do we do that? So that is where we measure, we then get into measuring fit. But we are going to discuss that a bit later. But how do we reduce that reducible error? Cool, right? So this happens when we're doing like for prediction purposes. When we're just doing for prediction purposes, right? All we care about is when we put in our variables, how accurate is our Y estimate going to be compared to our Y actual? And that accuracy is affected by two types of errors, reducible errors and irreducible errors. Those are the ones that are affected, right? Cool. Let's discuss the second type, the second reason why we estimate F. It is for inference purposes. Inference purposes. Cool. Let's see what this means, right? So sometimes we want to know the way Y is affected by the input variables. Here we wish to estimate F, but our goal is not to necessarily make the prediction for Y. So we have something like this, right? We want to estimate this, we want to create this estimate F, but our goal is not just to predict Y. We actually want to know the relationship between this Y and the X's. So what we want to know is how is Y going to change when we change our X's. How is Y going to change? We do not care what the Y value will be, but we are interested in the changes that Y is going to go through when we change our X's. So F is no longer a black box where we just put in values, we do not know care what is going on, and then it spits out a Y. We now need to know the actual form of X, of F, because if we know the actual form of F, we are able to know how changes in X are going to affect our Y, right? If it was a black box, we wouldn't even know. We'd just pump in our F and then we'd get a Y here, but we don't know what's going on here. But for inference, we need to know what is going on inside that black box, right? So questions that one might be trying to answer for inference purposes, you know, for prediction purposes, someone would be saying, what income level should I pay this person based on their age, right? So we do not care how it's going to be calculated. We just want to know the income level. We just want to know the Y. But in this case, when we're doing inference purposes, what questions are we trying to answer? Questions like, which X's are associated with the response? Which X's are associated with Y? Which ones of them? Because yeah, remember, when we just pump in, if it was just for prediction, we'd pump in all the X's and then we'd just get a Y. We do not know which ones it left out in here. But for inference, we want to know which ones should be left out, which ones are important, which ones are not important, right? So these X's, that's a term I should have started using a long time ago, but these X's are called predictors, because we use them to predict. Okay, so yeah, let's just call them predictors, because now it's inference, you might confuse. But these X's, they're called predictors, and the Y is called the outcome. I might use these terms here and there, so just know these two terms. Cool. So we want to know which X's are associated with Y, or which X's are important, which ones are not. So when we're doing like income, right, we know that income is going to be a function of age. So we are going to estimate our F as a function of age, years in school, the school the person went to, right? Some person might be like, yo, someone who's modeling this might assume that your income is also affected by your height. By your height, right? Be like, yeah, I think your height, if you're tall, probably you get more money. They might think that is an important factor, right? If we just wanted to estimate income or to just predict income, we don't care how F looks like, then we'd put in the age, the years, the school, the height, and then in the prediction or in reason number one, we just get the Y income. We don't care how it did that. But for inference, we want to know which X is associated with Y, which X is actually associated with income, which X is affect our income. And then when we do that inference, when you do for inference purposes, it's going to tell us if age is important, if years are important, if the school you went to is important, if your height is important. Now we know which ones are actually important, and we can take out ones that are not important. So it's no longer a black box that just crunches the numbers and then gives us a Y. It actually tells us if age is important, years, school, height, which one is important. So that is one question that you'll be trying to answer. The second question that you'll be trying to answer is, what is the relationship between Y and the X's? What is the relationship between your income and the A and these things? Is it a linear relationship? Is it quadratic? Or what is it? Do we have some logarithms in there? So that's what you're trying to see. What is the actual relationship between Y and X's, right? And the X's that are important. Is it going to be linear? Like Y is equal to 2X? Or is it going to be quadratic? Y is equal to 2x squared? Is it going to be logarithm? Y is going to log x? What is it? We need to know. We don't want to just give it as a black box where we don't know the relationship. We need to know the relationship, right? Question number three, you'll be trying to answer, like, can the relationship between y and each predictor or each x, right, can it be summarized using a linear equation, or is it the relationship more complex? Oh yeah, that's the one that we discussed here, right? Yeah, cool. So I think those are the three questions that you're trying to say. Is it linear? Is it quadratic? Is it logarithmic, right? So now that we have discussed those two, let me give you just examples to make these two concepts solid, or cement these two concepts. When we are doing for prediction purposes, where we just want the Y, we do not care what F is, we just want Y. Imagine that a company is interested in doing a direct marketing campaign. This company wants to market directly to its clients, right? Doing a direct marketing campaign. What will they do? They will measure what they want to predict. They want to predict the response to the marketing campaign. So the response to marketing campaign, is it going to be positive or is it going to be negative? Because companies, I think you've received emails from companies. They send you emails about their products. So they want to estimate, is this person going to react positively or they are not going to react negatively, right? So what they're going to do, they're going to take some measurements, maybe your age, your demographic things, your age, how you use their website or whatever it is, their platform, how you use their website, how many times you log in, your logins, how long you stay on the website. They are going to look at your gender, they're going to look at your location, things like location, etc, etc. So your demographics, right? And they are going to put this into a black box. Why a black box? Because their intent, their aim is just to see if you're going to react positively or negatively. They do not care how the function is going to calculate the result. They do not care. They're just going to put this in a black, like your age and stuff like that, into a black box. And the black box is just going to work out its magic. It's going to work out its magic and spits out whether it's going to be positive or it's going to be negative. Right? Is it going to be positive? Is it going to be negative? They don't care how it's doing that. They just want to know positive or negative, right? So That is predict, that is estimating f for prediction purposes. For prediction purposes, we do not care what the relationship is going to be, we just want to know whether it's positive or negative. But on the other hand, let's look at a company that is doing adverts, right? It's doing, the company is selling some stuff. Let's say BMW is selling cars, right? BMW is selling cars. And they're advertising on the TV, on the radio, and in newspapers. BMW might be interested in knowing which one of these media is effective. Is TV effective? Is radio advertising effective? Is newspaper effective? What I mean is, which one is going to increase their sales? But is it advertising in TV? Is it advertising radio or newspaper? They do that by creating a function that sells is a function of my TV budget, my radio budget, and they'll say, okay, cool, and my what? And the budget in the newspaper. And for them to answer that question of which media is important, they need to know the relationship between sales and TV, radio. So they need to know something like sales. Is sales going to be equal to 4 times TV budget plus 3 times radio budget plus 10 times newspaper? They need to know that. So which means they need to figure out the actual relationship, the actual form of F. If this is the form of F, now they'll know that, oh, okay, if we increase our TV budget by so much, it's going to increase by 4 times. Radio is going to increase by 3 times. It's going to increase our sales, I mean. So what I mean is, yeah, they know that our TV, now they know that, oh, our TV advertising, it improves our sales 4 times. Radio improves our sales 3 times. Newspaper adverts improve our sales 10 times. So now they can shift their budget, their advertising, towards something like newspaper maybe, because newspaper, that's where the meat is. That's where they'll get all their sales from. You see what I mean? So there's a big difference. These guys just wanted to know the result, but these guys actually want to dig deep into which one is important, which X is important. You get what I mean? So this one was, now this was an example of inference. And to end this video, as a data scientist or someone who's doing machine learning, you'd need to know what your purpose is. Are you going to do for prediction or are you going to do for inference? And sometimes you do a mixture. Especially when you're doing like income. When you're doing income level, first you'll be like, okay, which one is important? Age, years of experience, the school you went to, your height, etc. First you'll be like, okay, I want to do this for inference, because you want to know which factors are important. You'll be like, so height is not important at all, because maybe, yeah, it'll be zero times height. Zero height is not important. Cool. When height is not important, now you have a function of F, you have a function of the x's that is relevant, with the relevant x's, right? Cool. Then, when a person comes to your company, you can now use that proper function to estimate their income. So you have moved from just inference, where you infer the relationship, to predicting. Now you are using that good F to predict the person's income. So sometimes you have a mixture of both. You just need to know at that particular stage, what are you doing? Are you doing prediction or are you doing inference? Because there are some techniques that are going to be different for both of them. I hope in this video I've explained well the two reasons why we need to know our F, why we need to estimate our F. In the next video, we are going to see how we estimate our F. It's going to just going to be the basics. The whole book here is the whole course here is the estimation of F, right? Is estimation of F using things like linear regression or whatever it is. So in the next video, we're just going to do the basics, introducing what we are going to learn later in later videos. So stay tuned for that video. Wow, wrong one. Okay, cool.